you to get to the rapture, for you to go to heaven, you don't have no other way but to believe in the message, to get into the ark. And this ark, he has been built by William Marion Branham. If you don't get into the ark, you are going to perish, and you and your family. Okay, the Lord bless you tonight, my brothers and my sisters. I am so happy to be here in front of you. And today again, I believe that it's going to be a blessing speaking about the word of the Lord Jesus Christ. So if you have your Bible with you, I would like for you to stand up. And we are going to read the Bible, and we are going to try to find a topic to speak about it tonight. So as you are getting your Bible, I wanted to read on Joshua, the very first chapter. And we're going to start in the verse, the very first verse as well. Joshua, first chapter, and we're going to read in the first verse. The Bible said, after the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord said to Joshua, the son of Nun, Moses' assistant, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now, therefore, arise and go over this Jordan, you and all these people, into the land that I am giving to them, to the people of Israel. Every soul that, every place that the sole of your foot will tread upon, I have given to you, just as I promised to Moses. From the wilderness and this Lebanon, as far as the great river, the river of Euphrates, all the land of the Hittites, to the great sea toward, and the going down of the sun, shall be your territory. No man shall be able to stand before you all the days of your life. Just as I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will not leave you or forsake you. Be strong and courageous, for you shall cause these people to inherit the land that I swore to their fathers to give them. Only be strong and very courageous, being careful to do according to all the law that Moses, my servant, commanded you. Do not turn from it to the right hand or to the left hand, that you may have good success wherever you go. This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate on it day and night, so that you may be careful to do according to all that is written in it. For then you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have good success. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be frightened, and do not be dismayed. For the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. May the Lord have blessings in the reading of the word in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. So you may be seated. Okay, as we just read in the Bible, my brothers and my sisters, we read about Joshua, this great warrior. So I would like to speak about Joshua, the great warrior. Why? It's just because I love Joshua. This man of God is a powerful man of God. That's why I wanted to talk about him. So as we notice here, the Bible is talking about these people coming from Egypt, leaving Egypt in the bondage where they were, and going to the promised land. This people was the people chosen by God himself to be his property, to be his people, his own people. And God didn't want to have nobody's advice before for him to choose Israel to be his people. So he did it by his sovereign way. Because God is choosing his people, or God is doing anything that he wants to do by his sovereign way of doing things. So he doesn't need nobody to come and to help him out. Are you there with me tonight? So these people was chosen by God himself. And he chose Israel. He chose Abraham. And he told Abraham, Abraham, you are going to be called the father of the many nations, father of many people. And by that time, Abraham did not have no children at all. But the Lord God promised to Abraham that you are going to have children. And you are going to be called the father of many nations. But he told Abraham, Abraham, you have to make sure that your people will go into the bondage in a land very far away. But after a time, myself, I, the Lord, I shall come down and I shall deliver them from the bondage. Are you there with me? Somebody can say, I am there, Pastor. So these people, because the word of God can never fail, God said that these people shall go into the bondage in Egypt. And the Bible says in Matthew that the heaven and earth shall pass away, but the word of the Lord shall never pass away. So anything that God has promised in the Bible, even if it is a promise, even if it is for a blessing, or if it is for a cursing, you have to know that heaven and earth shall pass away, but this word of the Lord shall never pass away. So God has promised to Abraham. He said, Abraham, your people shall go into the bondage in a land very far away. But make sure, after some times, after 400 years, I will come down myself and I shall set them free from the bondage. And even if Pharaoh was stronger as he could be, but the word of the Lord shall be fulfilled. He has to be fulfilled, because he was not a prophet saying it. He was not a preacher. He was not a teacher saying it. But this was the Lord God saying it to Abraham. So he said, your people shall be in the bondage, but after a time, I shall come down and I shall set them free. Are you there with me, people? So tonight you have to know that even if you have problem, you have to know that even if you are passing through the trials in your life, you have to know that everything has a time. So you have to know that the Lord God who left you to go through the trials in your life, that same God is able to come down and to take you out of those trials in your life. Why? Because he is God and he knows everything. Somebody can say amen to it. And this God has promised. He gave some promise to Abraham. And he said, these people shall go into the bondage, and after a period of time, I shall come down and I shall deliver them. And these people, they went into Egypt in the bondage. They had a very bad time in Egypt, brother. They had to work very, very hard for Pharaoh. We all know the history. We all know what Pharaoh had to give them a very hard time to do the work for them. And we know that God, because he is a faithful God, because he is the one who keeps his promise, he's the God who keeps his word. So he had to come down to do something for these people. Oh, I'm feeling good now. Because he promised, he was able to fulfill his word, to fulfill his promise. You have to know the God that we are dealing with is not a human being. This God is not a man to lie. This God is perfectly able to keep his word. So before ever he gives a promise to somebody, he has to make sure that he is able to keep that promise. If he's not able to keep that promise, so he's not going to give the promise. So you have to know, any promise that the Lord gave to you in the Bible, he is able to keep to that promise. No matter what comes, no matter what goes, no matter how many people can betray you, no matter how many people can hate you, no matter what can come in your life, you have to know that God is able to keep his promises for you. He is going to keep his word. He is going to keep every single word that proceeded from his mouth. Are you there with me, people of God? So these people, they were in Egypt. And after sometimes, after 400 years, in the bondage, so the Lord God had to provide a way for them to come out. The Lord God had to provide a way for them to come out of the trial. And here the Bible say, these people, just after the time, they saw that Pharaoh was dead. So that time, for them, they found that there was a very good opportunity for them to call upon God, to try to remind him about his promises
to try to remind him about what he told Abraham. And they knew that God was able to remember about all the promises that he gave Abraham according to them. Somebody can say praise the Lord. So this time God came down. Why? Because these people, they cried upon the Lord. They prayed. They had some groanings. They prayed to the Lord. They said, God, try to remember that you are God, that you cannot fail us. You cannot fail your promises towards us. You, the one who promised, you said that after some times, you should come to take us out of this bondage. But see, we are suffering here. There is no way for us to go out of this place. Would you come down to help us? And the Bible says, they cried, came to the throne of the king. And God heard their groaning. God saw how they were crying. God saw the situation where those people were submitted. And the Lord God came down. So he had to provide. Let me tell you, my brothers and my sisters, the Lord God had to provide for you. If you arrive at the point that you cannot move any further, when you arrive at the point that you are feeling like you are arriving at the end of your life, that is not the end. When you are arriving at the place that you are thinking that you are done, that's not the time that you are done. That's the time that the Lord Jesus is coming down to start what he can do for you. Because where you are feeling like you don't have no more strength, that is the time that he is going to provide his perfect strength. Why? Because he told to our brother Paul, he said, when you are weak, that is the time that I'm going to show my perfect strength. So the perfect strength is coming in a perfect weakness. Somebody can say praise the Lord. So anytime that you feel like you are not strong, you are not weak, make sure the strength of the Lord shall not come to you. So sometimes you have to feel like you are weak. Sometimes you have to confess it. You have to tell the Lord Jesus, Father, I am feeling like I am weak. I cannot move again far away. I feel like this is the end of my life. I feel like I cannot do something special. So in that time, oh my, I'm feeling good. In that time, that is the time that is going to show you the perfect strength of ease. Why? Because our God is perfect. He is perfect in love. He is perfect in strength. He is perfect in might. He is perfect in everything. So the time that you are weak, that is the time that is going to come to show you his might. To show you his mighty hand. When? It's only when you are weak. And when you are weak, the solution for your weaknesses, it is not to talk to somebody else. It is not to murmur. It is not to be complaining all the time. But what you have to do is to come on your knees and to call upon the Lord God. To say, Lord God, would you come to help me? Because I know you are my perfect strength when I am in a perfect weakness. Amen. Amen. So these people, they find out, they end up to be weak. And they knew that was the only time that they had to call upon God. And they knew that's the time that they were weak. That was the time that God could do something for them. And they cried upon the Lord. And the Lord heard their cries. He heard their groanings. And he came down. And he provided for them a way to be delivered, to be set free from the bondage. And that way was no other but Moses. Moses was the perfect way of deliverance for these people. So Moses was the deliverance. Moses, he was the secret of the deliverance for Israelites. Moses was the man. Moses was the answer from the prayer. Moses was the answer from God. Moses was the perfect will of God. Nobody could take the place of Moses. Nobody could do what Moses done. Nobody was able to do it. It was only Moses. No matter how many times those people could go to school, no matter how rich these people could be, but nobody could take the place of Moses. Moses was special. So you are special. Nobody can take your place. You are you. You are special in the sight of the Lord. Nobody can take your place. Who can take your place? I don't see nobody. There's nobody who can take your place. You are so special. You are unique. You are you. Are you there with me? Sometimes the devil is lying to you. He's telling you like God doesn't know you. He's telling you like the Lord God shall never use you. He's telling you something different. You have to tell the devil, Satan, you are just a liar. Satan, you cannot give me discouragement. Satan, you cannot give me disappointment. Why? Because I know nobody can take my place. I am me. In the sight of God, I am very special. I am very important. Nobody can take my place. Nobody. Nobody can take my place. Nobody. Are you there with me? So Moses was special in the sight of God. And God had to use Moses for the deliverance of these people. And we know the story. How God had to take away all the theology from the head of Moses to give him some supernatural. This is the other point that we have to talk about. Because this is very important. Moses, he could not deliver those people only by a theory. No. Theology was not enough for Moses to set them free from the bondage. So they had to end the theology and the dynamic. So they had to have end the mechanics and the dynamics. That means they had to end the teachings and the power. Because no power, no deliverance. Deliverance is not coming through the teachings. No, sir. I said no to it. Deliverance is coming by a mighty hand of God. Deliverance is by power. It's not by ideology. It's not by teachings. It's not just by, because we are known to the Pope. We are known to the bishop. We are known to some. That's not the deliverance. Deliverance is coming by the power, the mighty power of the Lord Jesus. Are you there with me? Because Moses went to school. Moses, he had enough knowledge. He had enough knowledge to teach even to other people. Moses could do it. But Moses didn't have no power. Because he didn't have no power, so he had to kill somebody. He killed somebody. Why? Because Moses tried to do it in a other way, in a different way. That way was not God's way. God's way is always perfect. Always. I say always. Somebody can say praise the Lord. So Moses, he had the teachings, but only the teachings could not do anything for those people. They were slaves. They were slaves. They were in the bondage. Only the teachings, only the ideology could not help them out. So they had to have power to do something. Are you there with me? So nobody can be transformed only by the teachings. Nobody can have his life to be changed only by the theology. Theology will never help somebody. You need something greater than theology. You need something greater than knowledge. You need something greater than everything that you are learning to school. That something is the supernatural. That something is God himself. And God, you wish that you shall never learn him in school. You shall never know God by the teachings. You shall never know God by what you are learning in theology. God is known through his power of the resurrection. Somebody can say amen to it. So Moses had to face God. He has to meet God face to face and to talk to God in order to him to have a power. So power is not coming by the bishop, but power is coming through a personal experience with God. You have to meet God. You need to see God face to face. So there is so many teachers. There is so many preachers today. They never had any chance to meet God. That's why we have so many problems in our lives. That's why we have so many problems in America. That's why we have so many problems in our churches. It's because the preachers, the pastors, they never met God before. That's why we are seeing all this sin in the church. We are seeing the pastor going to get to the lodge to have some power in this world to do stuff which is not according to the Bible. It's only because they never met God. They never met God. And somebody, let me tell you, my brothers and my sister, I'm getting off from my trail, but I have to come back to this. But I have to tell you this. You have to know this. No preacher can preach this message. No preacher can preach the word of God unless he met God face to face. Somebody can say amen to it. He has to have a personal experience with God. God has to call him. God has to talk to you. He has to tell you what to do. If you don't meet God, how you can do it? How you can do it? How people will have their life changed? How people will have the supernatural in their life? How people will have the Holy Spirit in their life? There is no way about it. Why? Because the Bible says we give what we got. If you have the Holy Spirit, that is what you shall give to someone. If you don't have the Holy Spirit, so preacher, tell me, what are you going to give to someone else? Are you there with me? Moses, he was not commissioned to preach the gospel unless he met God face to face. Unless he had the supernatural. No preacher can preach the word unless you have the supernatural. The supernatural is God. Are you there with me? The supernatural is the mighty power of the Lord in your ministry. No supernatural. No God. No teachings. Because he will never help you out. He will never help somebody in the church. He will never help the church. That's why we see the church never grows. We see the church in America failing. We see people just coming in the church because they have to have knowledge. Just because they want to greet the hand of the pastor. But still they are in the bondage of drug addictions. They are in the bondage of all the sin. All the adultery. All the problems that we are seeing in their life. Why? It's because people don't meet God. That is the problem. Moses, he had to meet God. Moses, he had to be delivered himself first. So how can you preach deliverance without being delivered yourself first? There is no way. No way. How can you talk about the Holy Spirit if you don't have the Holy Spirit in you? There is no way. Sir, before you talk to me about the Holy Spirit, you have to prove to me that you have the Holy Spirit in your life. You have to tell me what is your personal experience with the Holy Spirit. How can you talk to me about the rapture if you don't have the Holy Spirit? How can you talk to me about love if you don't have love in yourself? How can you talk to me about riches, about blessings, if yourself you are poor? How am I going to believe to you? There is no way. That is impossible. You have to talk to me what you have experience of. Talk to me about something that you are living. If you want to talk to me about the Holy Spirit, make sure you have the Holy Spirit. Make sure that you have God. If you want to talk to me about the supernatural, sir, you need to show me the supernatural in your life. If you don't have the Holy Spirit, if you don't have the supernatural, leave the pulpit, sir. Am I clean enough tonight? Are you understanding what I'm talking about? If you don't have the Holy Spirit, if you don't have the Holy Spirit, if you don't have the supernatural, sir, leave the pulpit. Let the pulpit to those who have the Holy Spirit. I'm telling you the truth, my brothers and my sisters. You are not coming to this church just to see me. No, sir. You are coming to this church to see God, to have a personal experience with God. Something must happen in your life. If your life doesn't change, if nothing is happening in your life, so what's good for you to come in the church? What is good? You have been in the church so many years. You are not coming because your mother used to come here. You are not coming because your father used to come here. You are coming for yourself. And you need to meet God. You need to see God. So Moses could not preach the deliverance before himself being delivered first. Why? Oh, let me tell you, this is just coming to me. Moses, he was in the bondage the same way like those other Israelites. Do you understand what I'm talking about? Why? You can't. You are going to tell me, preacher, but Moses, he was in Pharaoh's house. Yes, sir. I say yes to it. He was in Pharaoh's house, but still he was in the bondage. Moses didn't know God. He didn't know anything about God. We don't learn God in school. No way to learn God in school. No way. Nobody can understand God. We believe God. We believe the word of God. We don't understand God. because we don't see him. No, there is no way to you. There is no God. No, there is no way for you to understand God. But you have to believe God. But Moses was in the bondage. That's the reason why he killed those Egyptians. He killed those Egyptians. Why? Because he was in the bondage. He was in the bondage of theology. He was in the bondage. So before for him to come to tell those people, I am the deliverer. I am coming down to deliver you from Egypt to go to the promised land. Himself, he had to be delivered. Himself, he had to have a personal experience with God. He had to show, to give some proof. So how can you tell me that I have to leave Pharaoh if you don't have any might to fight Pharaoh with? How? Pharaoh is strong, man. Pharaoh, he has an army. Pharaoh is well-organized, man. I cannot just put my life on the line like that. No, I have to make sure that if you say we are going to fight against Pharaoh, we have enough army. So Moses, I am feeling good, man. I am feeling good. I'm not talking about Moses today. Today I'm talking about Joshua. I can't talk about Joshua without talking about Moses, because Moses, Joshua equal Moses. So I don't have no choice. I have to talk about it. You have to bear with me. I have to talk about it. So Moses this time, he met God face to face in a burning bush. He saw God. God talked to him. God talked to Moses. He said to Moses, Moses, I have heard the cries of my people. I have seen the groanings of my people. So I come down. I am not down just to see them crying. I am not down just to show them some theology, to show them some pictures of myself. No, I am here to deliver them. I am here to set them free. And Moses, I am sending you down. You have to go do the work. Moses, how can I go? How can I take that adventure? How can I take that risk to go and to tell them the Lord told me that I have to come to deliver you from Pharaoh? Man, I'm going to die. What's going to happen after Pharaoh knows that I am coming for that? And the Lord God talked to Moses. Moses, what do you have in your hand? And Moses said, I have just a dry stick. He said, okay, you take that dry stick. That's going to be the army. That's going to be the army. That's going to be what you're going to use. Only a dry stick. I'm talking about the dry stick. What do you have in your hand? Only a dry stick, sir. I don't have no gun. I don't have no other material, but I have only a dry stick. A dry stick in the presence of the Lord is no more a dry stick. It is God's army. You know what? Pharaoh was not smart. Pharaoh was not intelligent. If Pharaoh was intelligent, the only thing that he could do, he was to take out that dry stick from the hand of Moses, and Moses could be powerless, because the dry stick was the might of Moses. That was the secret of Moses. And God told Moses, Moses, I will be with thee. That was enough. That was good enough for Moses to go to face Pharaoh. Why? Because the Lord God told him, Moses, I will be with thee. My brothers and my sisters, tonight you have this promise with you. The Lord God has promised you this. He said, I will never leave you alone. I will never forsake you. So you have this word of God with you. You have this promise. You can face the enemy tonight. You can face Pharaoh. You can face all the problems of your life, knowing that the Lord God is with you. He will never leave you. He will never forsake you. Are you there with me? You don't have any promise from Satan. Satan never promised you that I shall be with you all the time. No, Satan didn't say that, because he doesn't have that might to be with you all the time. But God can. God can. Can you say God can? God can. God can. God say he will be with me. So you don't have to scare the night. You don't have to scare any power. You don't have to scare nobody else, because the Lord God is with you. Are you there with me? So that was enough. That God just talked to Moses. He told Moses, Moses, I will be with you. Not the prophet will be with you, But I, the Lord, the Creator, I will be with thee. That was enough. And Moses, that old man, with 80 years old, he came down into Egypt. He said, I am coming down to take over. How are you going to take over, sir? Because the Lord God taught me. So what serve the Lord God told you tonight, you have to make sure that it's going to be accomplished. It's going to be fulfilled. No matter what your age is, your age doesn't mean nothing to the promise of God. Your age doesn't say nothing to the promise of God. The promise of God will be fulfilled because he's the master of the time. He's the master of all the circumstances. He's God and he changes not. He will do it for you. If you don't get it today, you shall have it tomorrow. If you don't have it tomorrow, you will have it the next day. If you don't have it the next day, you have to make sure that God will give it to you anyhow. Because he's God. I'm running after the time. I'm sorry, but I have to say this, brother. I have to drop this. So Moses met God, and he came into Egypt. And he told Pharaoh, you have to let these people go. But Pharaoh, he was in the will of God as well. Do you understand? Yes, sir. Do you understand that, brother? Yes, sir. Pharaoh, Moses was in the perfect will of God. And Pharaoh as well was in the perfect will of God. So sometimes those problems that you are having, those problems is a perfect will of God. So he knows why he's letting all these problems coming to you. He wants to show you how mighty he is. He wants to show you how powerful he is. How are you going to see the might of God if you don't have trials, if you don't have problems in your life? How are you going to see God in your life? The only way for you to see God is through the trials. If you ask Daniel, he's going to tell you the same thing. Daniel saw God in the time of his trials. Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, they had to see God only through the trials. Talk to Job. Job will tell you the same thing. Talk to all the saints of the Old Testament. They will tell you the same thing. So for you to see God, in order for you to see God in your life, you need to agree with the trials. It is through the trials that you will see God in your life. Somebody can say amen to it. Somebody say amen. Amen. So we see here in the Bible that this great servant of the Lord Moses, he had to do a certain job from God. So God told him to do something, so he had to do something. And the same Lord, the same God who told him to do the thing, is the God who was with Moses. So he had to help Moses, because Moses could not do anything without God. So you cannot achieve nothing in your life without God. Without God, nothing is possible. Everything will be impossible. But with God, oh my, all things is possible. Not only with God, but all with you. All things is possible. Do you believe today? You know why? Because the Bible says if you believe, everything will be possible to those who believe. So everything is possible to you because you are a believer. You are not tonight here because you have unbelief. Now you are here because you are a believer. You believe that you are here. So because you believe, so everything is possible. All things is possible to you who believes. Amen. Amen. Say amen, somebody. Amen. And we see here Moses. He had to take these people out from Egypt to take them where? To the promised land. And we know the story. We know everything which happened in the wilderness, all the miracles that the Lord did in the wilderness, we know everything. But we arrive at the point at some place that Moses had to disappear. Moses had to die because he was a human being. So a human being cannot live eternally. Sometimes in his life, he has to arrive at the point to die. So Moses, no matter how much God could use him, but still he was a human being. So Moses had to die. Moses had to die. But the work of the Lord had to continue. So who could continue the work? Because Moses had to die. But the work of the Lord shall not die. shall continue the way, but how to continue the way. So God, because he's the only one who chose Moses without any advice of nobody. So he was the same God to choose someone else to succeed, or to take the place of Moses to continue his work. Are you there with me? So the Lord God had to see who was faithful to Moses to take the place of Moses. Who could do what Moses was doing? Because the work was not for anybody. It was only for somebody who was elected, predestined to do that work. So nobody can be a preacher by himself. It's not because you have those diploma, those degree, those PhD that you are a preacher. No, sir. God has to call you. You have to be predestined to do the job. Say amen, somebody. How can you do the job if you're not commissioned to do the job? If you're not called to do the job, how are you going to do it? How? Tell me how. Who's going to pay you? Who's going to pay you? You can take this example. Go tomorrow morning. Go into the Walmart and just take a seat and sit down somewhere and try to help somebody over there. Tell them, I am working for Walmart. Nobody hired you to do the work. So who's going to pay you? You can work, but by the end of the week, nobody going to give you the check. Why? Because nobody called you to do the work. Nobody will give you the pay. Why? Because they didn't call you to. Nobody hired you to do the work. Probably they can't even call the police for you. They have to arrest you. Why? Because you are a robber. Nobody called you. Nobody told you to do the work. So how are you going to do it? So that the same way with this work that we are doing. We have so many robbers in this work. We have so many people. The Lord God doesn't even know them. He didn't call them to do what they are doing. That's the reason why many years that you are in the church, you are not changing. You are not seeing the miracle of God. You are not seeing the supernatural. Because the supernatural is the salary. It is the paycheck for that person that the Lord had to preach the gospel. If God hired you to preach the gospel, so he has to pay you. And I will pay. The way for him to pay us is by the supernatural. So you will see the miracles. You will see the lame walk. You will see the blind see. You will see the dead coming back to life. That is the supernatural. And God will not give it to anybody. He is giving it to those who he predestined. He called to do the work that they are doing. Are you there with me? Say amen, somebody. So the Lord God, after the death of Moses, he had to provide somebody. God had to call somebody. That's what we read in the Bible. The Bible says after the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord said to Joshua, the son of Nun, Moses' assistant, Moses' servant. So Joshua was not a servant of God before the death of Moses. So before Moses dies, Joshua was the servant of Moses. He was Moses' servant. What that is mean? That means that Joshua had the commission only to support Moses. Are you there with me? Joshua had to do only what Moses was telling him to do. Why? Because Moses was God's servant and Joshua never met God before. God never spoke to Joshua before the death of Moses. So Moses was the master of Joshua. Somebody can say amen to it. Do you understand what I'm talking about? So Joshua was Moses' servant. His job was to take care of Moses' business. To take care of the food of Moses. To take care of Moses' family. To take care of Moses' health. So that was the job. That was Joshua's job. And the Bible says, Joshua, son of Nun, Moses' servant. So he was not a servant of God. He was not a servant of the Lord. He was the Moses' servant. But being Moses' servant, he was a faithful servant. That's why God had to use him after the death of Moses. Why? Because Joshua was there He was there to see what Moses was doing. Joshua had faith in Moses. Joshua knew the God of Moses. Are you there with me? We have so many people today trying to preach the message, but they are not faithful to William Branham. I have to tell this. I have to drop this. I have to drop it. Being faithful to William Branham is being faithful to the entire message. You have to be faithful to the entire message for you to take the place of a preacher, for you to preach this gospel and to have the supernatural in your life. You have to be faithful. Your life has to be faithful according to the message, according to the Bible. You have to live a correct life, a sanctified life. You have to give glory only to God, not to nobody else. Not to nobody else. We don't have two gods. We have only one God. His name is the Lord Jesus Christ. There is nobody who can take his place. There's nobody. Nobody. Are you there with me, somebody? So Joshua was faithful to Moses. Joshua, he was believing to the message of his hour. Joshua, he was living according to that message. He was living according to the pillar of fire. I have to drop this. Are you there with me? Joshua, his life was influenced by the life of Moses. And Moses' life was influenced by the pillar of fire. So Joshua, he had an experience with the pillar of fire. Joshua could not put a step somewhere before the pillar of fire moves. Are you there with me? So Joshua, he had his eyes upon Moses, like Moses had his eyes upon the pillar of fire. And the pillar of fire is nothing else but God. God himself. So after the death of Moses, somebody had to take the place. Somebody had to continue the work. Somebody had to take those people to bring them to the promised land. Because the promise of God shall never fail. Never. God said, you will leave Egypt. And you will go to the promised land. So the destination, it was not the wilderness. The destination, the end of the way, it was the promised land. So even if you want it, or if you don't want it, you have to make sure that you have to get into the promised land. Why? Because God didn't see the wilderness. God saw the promised land. So tonight you have to tell the devil, Satan, God did not see the wilderness. He didn't see all the problems that I'm having, but he saw my blessing. He saw the promised land. So I have to make it. No matter what, I will make it to the promised land. No matter how weak I am, no matter how many trials I'm having, but I have to make it, and I shall make it. No matter the opposition, no matter the sickness, no matter what coming, no matter what goes, I know that I will make it. Make it where? To the promised land. There is a promised land. The promised land is a reality. The promised land is a reality. What is the promised land? The promised land is the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is a reality. I know that I shall make it. I know that I will get to the promised land. I will get to the Holy Spirit. No matter if I am failing today. No matter if I am weak today. I know tomorrow, sir, I will have the Holy Spirit. Why? Because the Lord God promised it to me. It is a promise. The promise to me. It is a promise to my family. It is a promise to my son. Yes. I will receive the Holy Spirit. Yes, I will receive it. Amen. Yes, I will. Yes. So Joshua, he had to take these people from the wilderness. You have to notice this. Moses took them from Egypt to the wilderness. And Moses died. So Joshua had to take them from the wilderness to the promised land. Moses, he done a great job. But Joshua, he done a great, a marvelous, a wonderful job. A big job, better than Moses. Why? Because Moses did not take them to the promised land. Moses took them from the bondage to the wilderness. And the wilderness is still the problem. It's still the trials. The time they were in the wilderness, Jordan was still there. And the problem was still there. Somebody had to take them from the wilderness to the promised land. And that person was Joshua. Joshua was great, sir. He done a great job. Joshua. My, I love Joshua. This great warrior, Joshua. Joshua. So he had to take the place of this mighty man, Moses. They never and ever existed a prophet like Moses. No. The Bible says, if you have a prophet, I am talking to him from mouth to his ear. But Moses, no, sir. I'm talking to him face to face. Moses was great. The great was Moses. So someone has to take the place of a great prophet. And that someone was Joshua. Sir? Sir? Stop kidding, man. Joshua was not small, man. No, Joshua was great, man. To take that place. So the Bible says, Joshua, now my servant is dead. You, Joshua, you have to take the place of my servant. You have to take the place of Moses. You have to take these people from the wilderness to take them to the promised land. And Joshua said amen to it. He said, I agree. So I'm not going to do it. Look at this commission. Joshua, as I was with Moses, I shall be with you. The same way. Wow. Joshua said, wow. With Moses, man, with Moses, he could kill those people in Egypt. With Moses, he could open up the Red Sea. With Moses, he could provide manna coming from heaven. With Moses, he could do all this stuff that we saw. With Moses, we could see the pillar of fire moving. Now he says he's going to be with me the same way. Oh my, I say yes. Yes, I agree. I'm going to take these people. No matter what, I'm going to do it. I'm going to do the job. Oh my, there is so many mystery in here, man. And the Bible says here, God said to him, Joshua, because you accepted it, look, I'm going to pay you. Every place that the sole of your foot will tread upon, I give it to you. Wow. Every place, the Bible says, is going to be given to me. Just only when my foot tread upon it, that place is my possession. Wow, so how can I fail in my life? I don't have no reason for failing. How am I going to fail? Because the Bible says, any place that the sole of my foot will tread upon, it shall be given to me. Not that I'm going to fight to have it. No, he said, it shall be given to me. It is mine. So any footprints of mine, that means that is my possession. If they try to call me even to do the interview in a job place, make sure that place is mine. If they call me, even if I go to school even once, if I go only to have some instructions from school, even if I arrive only at the point, that place is mine. My, this is powerful. This is really powerful. And this promise shall never fail because God said it. Are you there with me? I don't know how much time do I have left. Oh my. Hey, yeah, the Bible say, just bear with me, I'm going to finish very soon. The Bible said, now, no man shall be able to stand before you all the days of your life. Nobody should be able to stand before you. Nobody. No opposition shall be able to stand before you as long as you are living. Why? Because the same way that I was with Moses, that is the same way that I'm going to be with you. In Moses, he was down as simply God. in Moses, he was the supernatural God manifesting the supernatural stuff in the life of Moses. So the same God being with Joshua that ministered the same supernatural stuff that was manifesting in the life of Moses should be manifested in the life of Joshua. So Joshua was a supernatural man. Because he had to walk with the supernatural. He had the supernatural God walking through him. Are you there with me? Somebody can shout amen. So Moses died. And Joshua had to believe in the supernatural. He had to believe that God was supernatural. That God was the Almighty God. That God was able to help them from the wilderness to take them to the promised land. And God told him, he said, I will never leave you. Nor forsake you. Be strong and courageous. This is yours tonight. No matter how trials that you are having. No matter what's the problem. No matter what's the issues that you are having. No matter what you have issues. You have to know that the Bible says, I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. I shall be with you exactly like I was with Moses. I shall never leave you. And nobody shall be able to stand before you as long as you are living. Only be courageous. This is what God is telling you tonight. Just be courageous. He said, be courageous. Why is he saying it? It's because some situation in your life will make you to be weak, will make you to be discouraged. So God has already provided for that situation. And he's telling you, just be courageous. No matter what, just be courageous. No matter what comes, just be courageous. No matter what goes, just be courageous. Just be courageous, my brother. My sister, let me tell you tonight. Let me give you some encouragement. Just be courageous. Because you will make it. Even the devil is informed that you will make it. No matter how much a bluff he can show to you, the devil is informed. That you are not fighting to a victory, but you are always already in victory. Victory is yours. Satan knows it. He knows about it. He knows that your name is victory. Satan knows about it. Just be courageous. Just be courageous. The Lord God is with you. Only be strong and very courageous. Being careful to do according to all the law of Moses that Moses, my servant, commanded you. Be courageous. Just be courageous. Can you tell your neighbor? Tell him, my brother, just be courageous. Tell your sister, just be courageous. Tell your brother, just be courageous. Be courageous. God is in your side. God will never leave you. He will never forsake you. Just be courageous. Just be courageous. You know what? The devil is informed that you will never lose the battle. He knows that you will make it. Joshua was called. Joshua was elected. He was elected by God. He was nobody else electing Joshua, but it was God electing Joshua. Joshua means God. Joshua means Jehovah the Savior. Joshua means Jesus. Joshua. Oh my, the prophet say, I never saw any commander, any general like Joshua. Joshua, he was a courageous man. He was a strong man. Joshua was like Shemker. He was this person who could never retreat. Never. Joshua, he knew only how to press on. You have only to press on, my sister. Sharon, you have to press on. No matter what, you have to press on. You need to keep pressing on, my brother. You need to keep pressing on. I bet you have to press on. There is no situation which is going to be bigger than your faith. No. No, your faith is greater than all the trials that you have. And even if you are in a trial, you have to know that God will make a way for you to come out of that problem. Why? Because he's a way maker. He knows how to make a way. He's your God. So he knows how to make a way. Even in the wilderness, he knows how to help you out. He knows how to help you out. Just be courageous. Be courageous, my brother. Joshua, he was the leader. Joshua, he was this person who believed the word of God. no matter how much the opposition was there. But Joshua and Caleb, they believed in the word of God. You know the prophet say that in the wilderness there were about 2 million of people. But the word of God only took effect in two people. The word of God took effect in Joshua. The word of God took effect in Caleb. Joshua, he was this person who believed God. He took God by his word. God said, the promised land is mine. I believe the promised land is mine. No matter how much, how great the opposition is, I don't care about the opposition. I don't even want to see the opposition. I don't want to see Goliath in my life. I don't want to see nobody fighting me in my life. I want to see the victory. I want to see the promised land. I want to see my blessing coming to me. That is only the thing that I want to see. Are you there with me, somebody? Oh my. Joshua was called. Joshua was elected. Joshua was the greatest servant of God. Joshua was the great warrior. The Lord God chose Joshua. Why? Because Joshua was a courageous man. No matter what, the people was dismayed. No matter what, the people were discouraged. But Joshua was not discouraged, because Joshua was taking God upon his word. And he knew that God was going to fulfill what he promised to them. Are you there? And God did it. God did it. You know, even though there was thousands and thousands of noblemen in the wilderness, but Joshua knew who he was. He knew where he was standing at. He knew his position. He knew that he was not somebody like other people. He knew that he was different. Oh my, he knew that he had a call in him. So you have to know who you are. Are you there? Before for you to have victory, you have to realize who you are. You are not what the people are talking about you, but you are what God is saying that you are. You are not the failure. Your name is not the failure. Your name is victory. Your name is the Son of God. Your name is Miss Jesus. Your name is Jesus. Your name is the victory. Even Satan is informed about it. Your name is not what your father gave to you, but your name is Jesus. Just be courageous tonight. Be courageous. Are you there with me, somebody? Are you there with me, somebody? Just be courageous tonight to face all the problems that you have. You don't have to retreat, but you have to go through those problems and to have victory. You have to take those problems. I will never retreat. Never. Never. Joshua. Before Joshua, let me tell you this. This is very important for you to understand. You know Joshua, he was working with Moses. Joshua, he knew what's the experience that Moses had. Joshua, he saw the pillar of fire moving. He saw it. Are you there? Because he could not move before the pillar of fire moves. So he had to see the pillar of fire. He had to check on the moves of the pillar of fire's move. So he had to check God before he moves. Are you there with me? But he arrived at the point after the death of Moses that seeing the pillar of fire was not enough. It was not enough. But he had to have some experience with that pillar of fire. He had to meet the pillar of fire. Are you there with me? So Moses saw the pillar of fire. But Joshua, he saw beyond the pillar of fire. Beyond the pillar of fire. To have victory upon Jericho. So for you to have victory, you need to fix, you need to put your eyes upon the pillar of fire and to see what is inside of the pillar of fire. Because the pillar of fire is just a cover. It is covering something. But inside of the pillar of fire, there is something. And that something which is inside, that is God. Are you there with me, sir? So you know the Bible said Jericho was there. Jericho was a reality. They had to face Jericho. They had to conquer Jericho. But how can you conquer Jericho without the help of God? God has to help you. God has. He has to do something for you in order for you to conquer Jericho. And here we see Joshua, he saw Jericho was there.
And sometimes he was working. He was trying to, I don't know what he was looking. He was looking for. Maybe he was just looking for a place to pray or something like that. And the Bible says he met somebody. He met the person who was inside of the pillar of fire. That person, the pillar of fire, he was a light walking in front of them. They saw the pillar of fire moving. But he arrived at the point. The pillar of fire left the air. The pillar of fire has to come down. And the pillar of fire came down. And Joshua saw the pillar of fire down. And he saw in the pillar of fire that somebody coming out. So he saw the pillar of fire being transformed. The pillar of fire was no more the pillar of fire, but the pillar of fire became a man. And that man was the captain of the host of the Lord. And that person is nobody else but God himself. So Joshua, he had to meet God. He had to face God face to face before for him to have victory upon Jericho. Before you have victory in your life, you need to see God face to face. God has to talk to you. He has to tell him, to tell you what to do. And God told Joshua, Joshua, for Jericho, you don't have to fight. What you have to do is just to praise me. Just circle around the town, the city. Just circle around every day. Just do it once. And in the seventh day, do it seven times. And you will see the glory of the Lord. So this is a mystery. This is a great mystery inside. And Joshua had to do it. Why? Because God told him. And because God told him, so that was the secret of Joshua. So he had to stay upon what the Lord told him. That was the victory. If you want to have victory, my brother, you have to stay upon what the Bible says. Because victory is not in something else, but victory is in the word of God. Are you there with me? Nobody can succeed in his life without the word of God. Nobody, sir. Nobody. The word of God, which is written in the Bible, he is the blood in our vein. He is our life. Somebody can say amen to it. So Joshua had to stay upon what God said to him. This captain of the host of the Lord. And we know what happened next. Joshua had to have victory. So today, I spoke to you about this great warrior. Joshua. Joshua had faith to God. He had faith in the word of God. Joshua knew that whatsoever the Lord God spoke was going to come to pass. Why? Because God's word will never fail, will never pass away, but will be fulfilled in the due season. Are you there with me? So today you are a warrior, exactly like Joshua was. So what you have to do is you have to be courageous. You have to stay upon the word of God. You don't have to turn around. You don't have to go no in the right side, no in the left side. But you have to meditate this word. You have to stay in the word of God. Are you there with me? So you have to bear with me. I have to drop this. When I am talking about the word of God, I am talking about the end time message. You have to know that in every age, the Lord God is sending a message. The Lord God is sending a prophet. The message for this hour is not the message of Moses. It's not the message that the Lord talked, who he spoke to Mary. It's not what the Lord God talked to Noah. It's not what the Lord God talked to any ages. But in this age, there is a message that you have to believe in it for you to make to the rapture, for you to go to heaven. Are you there with me? I have to talk about it. You have to put your trust in the message preached in this hour by the prophet William Marion Branham. You have to believe in it. You have to meditate it day and night for you to get to heaven. If you don't believe in this message, you have to make sure that you will perish. It is simple. In this age, we have a message. We receive the message exactly like in Noah's time, exactly like in Moses' time. In the time of Moses, for somebody to be delivered, he had to believe in Moses. He had to follow Moses. He had to get out of Egypt and to go to the wilderness to get to the promised land. In that time, my brother, for you to get to the promised land, you had to follow what Moses said. Somebody can shout amen to it.
If you don't want to believe to Moses, there is no promised land. Because if you don't believe in Moses, you will never believe in Joshua. Never. Never. There is only one way to for you to get saved, to be delivered, is to believe in Moses, to believe in the message of Moses. Somebody can say amen to it. In the time of Noah, the Lord God spoke to Noah. He said, soon I am going to destroy the world. So I am sending you, Noah, to build the ark. And everybody who wants to be saved, who wants to have his life to be saved, he had to get into the ark. If you don't get to the ark, you will perish. So this is the same way, sir. We don't have no other thing to say but to say what I am saying. In this age, for you to get to the rapture, for you to go to heaven, you don't have no other way but to believe in the message, to get into the ark. And this ark, he has been built by William Marion Branham. If you don't get into the ark, you are going to perish, and you and your family. Are you there with me? It is too hard for you to swallow this. Man, you have to swallow this, man. This is to give you some vitamins in your body, man. You have to believe in the message of the hour. You don't have to believe in the message of Moses, because it's not going to take you somewhere. It's going to take you to death. You don't have to believe in Mary, because it's going to take you to death. But you have to believe in a present time message. And this message, this is the Holy Spirit. And out of this message, there is the Holy Spirit. Out of this message, there is no life. No life. Out of this message. So when I'm talking about God's word, I am talking about the message of the hour. You need to believe in it. Everybody wants to be saved. If you want to be saved, you need to believe in the message of the hour. So this is the message to get you out from Egypt, to take you to heaven. Somebody can say, praise the Lord. Somebody can say, thank you, Lord. My brothers and my sisters, you have to believe in the word of the Lord Jesus. Believe in the message. Preached today by the mighty prophet of God, William Marion Branham. If you believe in the message, that is the only way for you to be saved. This is the only way for you to escape in the destruction of this world. Because you need to make sure this world is getting to the point to be destroyed. And it's going to be destroyed very soon. You have to make sure that the bride shall go into the rapture before this world to be destroyed. And that's not going to take long enough now. Soon we are leaving this world and we are going back to our country. We are going back to our city where the Lamb shall be the light. Somebody can say, praise the Lord. Man, I have to finish this, man. I may stop. I have to stop it, man. I have to stop it because I'm taking too much time. But you have to notice this. Joshua, the great warrior, he believed in the message of his hour. The message was believing in Moses. And in this hour, you have to believe the message preached in this hour. And that message is preached by William Marion Branham. If you believe in it, that's how you're going to be saved. If you don't believe in it, you shall perish. That is simple. To get your life to be saved. In the time of Noah, it was to get into the ark. If you don't get into the ark, you're going to perish anyhow. You're going to perish. Are you there with me? Joshua the great warrior, he took the people out from the wilderness to the promised land. Joshua is nobody else but the Holy Spirit. Today the Holy Spirit is there to take you out from the denomination, to take you to the promised land. The Holy Spirit is here to help you out, to deliver you from the bondage of sin, where you have been You have been a slave of sin so many, many years of your life. So this is the time for you to say no to it and to follow the Holy Spirit. I believe that you're believing on what I'm preaching. I believe that you understand what I'm preaching, right? So for today, I have to stop here. And I believe we will have another time, and we will keep on talking about Joshua the great warrior. So God bless you richly, my brothers. And God bless you richly, my sisters. Shall we pray tonight? Okay, if you have any problem, just lift your hand where you are. If you are following me on TV, just touch where you are sick, and I am going to pray for you. And I know that God will do something for you. Let's pray the Lord. Jesus Christ, our God, I just preach the gospel that you have put in my heart, Father. I believe that it's you, God, who spoke to your people today. Father God, I'm praying for my brothers and my sisters. You know the problem that they are having right now. Father, I'm praying for you to give them the victory. I am praying for you to move, Father, in a mighty way, oh Lord, and to touch their life today. Father, whosoever who desire the Holy Spirit, Father, I know that you are willingly to give it to anybody who wants it, Father. So today is the day. Father, give to them the Holy Spirit in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Whosoever who is sick, oh God, you are Jehovah. Jehovah, our healer. Father, I am praying for you to reach your hand upon my brothers and my sisters. No matter what's the problem, what's the sickness that they are having, no matter how the science has called that problem, no matter what's the name, the beautiful name that the science, the medicine, the doctor has gave to that problem. They may call it cancer. They may call it tuberculosis. They may call it allergies. They may call it asthma. They may call it on top the name of, they can give it. Father, I know the Bible is calling that demon. And you talk to me in the Bible, Father, that I will cast out the demon and all the demons shall go away. Father, today I'm coming to the authority that you have given to me, Father, to cast out all the devil, to cast out all the demons in the life of my brothers and my sisters, wheresoever they are, in the beds of the hospital right now, in their homes, in the church, wheresoever they are, Father, I am casting out that demon in the name of Jesus. Satan, get out of my brother. Satan, get out of my sister. Go into the wilderness in the mighty name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, reach your hand upon my brother. Reach your hand upon my sister, oh Lord. I am begging for you, God, to heal them. Oh, Father, I want for them to have testimonies in their life. They believe in what I just preached, oh Lord. I know that I have said the truth. I know that everything that I've said in here, Father, it is the truth. So, Father, come down and vindicate this truth that I just preached to your people. Father, give them what the desire of their heart is in the name of the Lord Jesus. You, Satan, you don't have no legal authority to be in their body. So I am casting you out in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Get out of their body. Get out of their business. Get out of their studies. Get out of their family in the name of the Lord Jesus and go into the wilderness. Father God, I know that you hear my prayer when I pray. Father, I want for you to give them what is the desire of their heart in the mighty name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we will be careful to give you praise and honor because we pray and believing that you hear our prayer in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, the mighty name, the only name that has been given to us. Oh, Father, this is the name giving to us the victory and giving to us everything that we desire. Father, we pray and we believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen, amen. Amen, amen. So God bless you, my brothers and my sister. May you have a wonderful day today. And I believe next time we will meet again and we will continue talking about Joshua the Great Warrior. And after Joshua the Great Warrior, we will make up a way to talk about another warrior because I want to build up a little bit your faith. I want you to have your faith very strong because we are living in these days that we have so many problems, so many trials, so many difficulties in our life. So we need to have a very strong faith to receive anything from our God. So I will keep on preaching about the warriors for few days. And after that, we will have to change our subject. May the Lord bless you and may you go back at your houses in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. God bless you.